Last week.
Nicodemus and the woman at the well.
What's that?
Nicodemus and the woman at the well. Or a mile.
That was a week before.
I don't think it
was. It's interesting. The only account of this is given in the Gospel of John. That's right. We talked about Lazarus last week. So, allow me tonight, the passage that we're going to talk about isn't at length in John. You can turn there if you want in John chapter 2. I'm going to be there in a little bit. Focus in with me, because I really want to share some things tonight that we are looking at John and what sets him apart, what makes him different than all the other synoptic gospels, or those gospels that blend together and give us the life and the ministry of Jesus Christ. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John together do that. Though four different men, they give us a complete, Brother Craig, look at this life, the birth, the growing up part of that. Much of it is very much obscure. We don't see it. But then we see much about his ministry. But however, when we come to John is a little bit set apart from Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It isn't just that he's the last gospel chronologically involved, however he is. But what makes him different? Let's talk about a few things. What? Love definitely makes a difference, and you hit the nail on the head there. John, he doesn't give us an account of the birth of Jesus. You won't see anything about the birth of Jesus in his account. You won't see anything about the baptism of Jesus. He doesn't give us that account that the other Gospels give. Doesn't say anything about his temptations in the wilderness. It doesn't give us anything about the Last Supper in the Gospel of John. We don't see anything about Gethsemane. We don't see anything about his ascension. We don't hear anything about him casting out demons or evil spirits. John doesn't give us that. And John doesn't look at the parables the way that the other three synoptic gospels do. John, when we look at him, we would say that John, in his gospel, it's not descriptive, but it's more reflective. What do I mean about that? Because John, and I'll tell you a little bit more about this later, John doesn't, Sister Tina, just give us account of the here and now. But time passes, and John has some time to reflect and look and be able to put this into perspective. Wow. Let me just say here, I know I'm all alone here, but I look back at my life, and I think about some words that I've said, and I wish I would have never said. And I look back at how I've responded to some things and decisions that I've made. It's not really been correct. If I could do it all over, Brother Doug, I'd change it. But in the here and now, it kind of seems right. And so here is these gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They're kind of giving us the here and now. But John says, Brother Dennis, I see things a little bit differently. The gospel is no longer just to the Jews, but now we have it to the Greeks and to the Gentiles. So Sister Rachel, he's writing to present Jesus in a different light. We'll talk more about that in just a few moments. And so John, he gives a lot more account of the ministry of Jesus even to Jerusalem. Now Matthew and Mark and Luke doesn't do that. But when we come and we see him crying and weeping for Jerusalem, it just looks like here's the event when we look at Matthew, Mark, and Luke. But John gives us more ministry in Jerusalem that shows us his love, his zeal, his compassion as he weeps over Jerusalem. And so John's gospel gives us a clearer understanding of the ministry of Jesus. He focuses on things not just in like a one-year event. If we look at Matthew, Mark, and Luke, most commentators would say, you look at that, you kind of get an event that looks like a year. But you look at John, Now it looks like 3 to 4 years. So now you have his ministry as it has blossomed, and it's a much broader, fuller picture that is given to us. John alone tells about the feast of Cana in Galilee. He alone tells about the Nicodemus coming to Jesus by night. He alone tells about the woman of Samaria. He alone tells about the raising of Lazarus. In chapters 14 through 17, he alone talks about the Holy Ghost, the Comforter, and gives us more information on that. It's John who brings to light particularly three men. Thomas, he tells us more about Thomas, chapter 11, chapter 14, chapter number 20. He tells us more about Andrew in chapter number 1, chapter number 6, chapter number 12. And then he gives us glimpses of the character of this man named Philip, who we wouldn't know much about his character, but John gives us that information. So John, he alone tells us a little bit too about what happens when they're just at the foot of the cross. There are soldiers who gamble over the seamless garment of Jesus as he's dying. John tells us that. And John, he is so precise in things. He alone tells us the weight of what the myrrh and the aloe was that was put on the body of Jesus. And so he's being specific in these things. And he remembers the beautiful smell of the perfume that was at Bethany. He looks at the humanity of Jesus. Don't lose me. I'm just trying to show you the importance of the Gospel of John. As he's looking at the humanity of Jesus, he uncompromisingly stresses his humanity. Jesus, he gets angry at the temple. He shows humanity. Jesus is angry. It shows who he was as a man. It says that he gets tired as he sits at the well there at Sychar. He meets a woman in Samaria. He's tired. He's a man. He's showing his storytelling to people. And basically, everybody has their story to tell. Any of you remember when you sat down with your grandma and grandpa? And I wish I would have been more attentive, Brother Doug, as they told their story. But it was their story to tell, and they told it their own way. You know, Brother Craig, you may tell about your marriage to Sister Rachel, meeting her and courting it. It's your story. And then Sister Rachel said, "Oh, kids, that was your daddy's side of the story. But this is my story, and this is how I tell it. It's mine." Only you can tell your story, Brother Doug. Sister Tina can tell part of it, but you can say, "No, this is my story." And so that's John. He said, "This is my story. I'm telling you about a God who robed himself in flesh." John does something different than all the other gospel writers. He tells about not Jesus being born in a manger. He doesn't tell about his earthly birth, but he looks at his eternal existence. Amen. God who always has been. And he robes himself in flesh. And then he tells how that Jesus, he was thirsty on the cross. He's the one that said, Jesus said, "I thirst." He was man. He was God who so loved the world, John 3:16, who gave his only begotten Son, amen, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. John tells the message of Jesus as man. His weariness, his exhaustion, the wounds of his body, the stress of his mind. But then he begins to talk about the preexistence and the deity of Jesus Christ. This is important for us to know as believers, that he robed himself in flesh, but he is God, the deity of him. John stresses those I ams. In John chapter 5, verse number 8, "Before Abraham was," Jesus said, "and I am." I am the one who was here long before the world began. I am deity. I'm the one who always has been and always will be. And then listen to this. You know what John does? He shows Jesus in his flesh, and he shows him in his deity. And then he does this. He shows his omniscience. What is that? That he knows all things. How do you think, John, the floor's open, what is some way that you think, and maybe something I don't have or haven't read, studied, prepared for that, maybe you'll be able to present that. What do you think is some ways in which Jesus showed his omniscience? That John specifically would focus on. I mean, it could be in John, however.
Well, I'm already asking sometimes things get blurred over.
Yeah.
Or the statements alone of, I am the door, I am the shepherd, the I, for I am, showing his omnipotence going all the way back to Moses there at the burning bush, where he said, who shall send us to me? And God will tell him, I am.
So that shows that God is, what would be some things that shows that he knows, God already knows? His omniscience. Sister Rachel. Absolutely. So his experience there with Nathaniel. Anything else?
I like the first passage of John because it shows back, shows his part of the God and his creation, especially verse 3 when it says, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made.
So he was always there. He knows all things. Anyone else? Absolutely, these are good. How about the woman at the well? That he shows omniscience to her. He said, wait a second. You've been married 5 times. And the fella you're with now, he's not your husband. Whoa. Come meet a man who told me all things I've ever done. He is omniscient. He knows all things. How about the man who was at the pool waiting for the waters to be troubled? Jesus knew how long he'd been there. How did he know? Because he is God. What about, we talked about Lazarus last week. What do you notice about Lazarus? The message comes by the servant that Lazarus is sick, right? Yeah, he already said, oh Lord, we know that's good. He's sleeping, he'll get rest. No, he's dead. Jesus was very plain. He's dead. He died. Did someone tell Jesus he died? No. He knew he was God. So John shows us several things. We're going to see something else, Brother Justin?
No, I just...
So we see that he shows us his humanity, that he was man. He shows his deity. He shows his omniscience, that he is God. Amen. So undeniably, he is human. And undeniably, he is God. These are important things for us to know, because Jesus would be a liar if we did not have validation to who he said that he was. And so John gives us this validating information because his name as the writer of this fourth gospel, he's talking to Gnostic people. He's talking to the Greeks. The Christianity is going out to. It's not just something that's assumed or known, but this is what you need to know to accept him as your Savior. See, there's so much we can say about John. We know that he was the younger son of Zebedee. And he possessed a boat that was on the Sea of Galilee. Here's some things I haven't really even thought about, but reading, and then you read another scripture and commentaries, bouncing back and forth. This is interesting. But if you read in Mark chapter number 1, verse number 19, you'll find that probably he and his brother were there with Peter. We'll talk a little bit more about that. They were kind of in business together. Probably thought of being in business together. And then you look at the Word of God and the relationship that continues with them. But when Jesus calls John and his brother, sons of Zebedee, They leave the boat, and Brother Dennis, the Bible says that they leave their hired servants behind. Here were some men that had a business. They're businessmen, but God called them to follow Him. Would anybody know what their mother's name would be by chance? Yes, you hit the nail on the head. Salome, however. And it is thought, and this is interesting. So now we have James and John, sons of Zebedee, sons of thunder, businessmen, probably partners with Peter here on the Sea of Galilee. And their mother is Salome. So does anyone know who her sister may have been? Sister Rachel, you're smiling. Do you know? Mary, the mother of Jesus. So you see all this connection. Who ever thought of this when you're reading John? And so, potentially a cousin of Jesus. And you can read much about this. Matthew 27, verse number 56. Mark 16, verse 1. You can see in Mark 1:20, he obeyed the call of Jesus. Luke 5 or 7 through 10, you can see the relationship that he has with Peter. And obviously, we see that there is an inner circle that Jesus has. Who's the inner circle? Peter, James, and John. These fishermen from the Sea of Galilee who were probably in business and worked together. And here they are being part of the inner circle of Jesus. Now, he was probably a man who probably spoke his mind, thumbs asunder, speaking of his aggressiveness. When I read about him, and this isn't popular today, but most commentators say he was a pretty intolerant man. And so here is this John. And we find that in the book of Acts, he always appears with his companion Peter, but he hardly says anything. Peter's saying everything. Isn't this interesting that he would give us the gospel? He kind of is this man of force, but yet when we come into Peter, how the Holy Ghost changes him. And he's mentioned several times in Acts. And then in Paul's letter, it appears only once in Galatians 2:8. He's named among the pillars of the church. So John, now we know some things about him. We know that he's an aggressive type guy. He's an owner of a business. His mother Salome, nephew of Mary, the mother of Jesus, cousin of Jesus, with his brother, and now part of the inner circle with Peter. And so that's who he is. And so he's a mixture of all kinds of things. And he was certainly one of the leaders of the 12, the disciples. And as we look at him, we find that, once again, he's giving this account as probably sometime, some folks feel 100 years has passed since a lot of all this is unfolding. Probably not quite 100 years, because you're looking at the life of Jesus as he divides time, but certainly some 70 years as he begins to write his gospel. Not as much as being, as I said before, descriptive, but being reflective of everything that's happened in these 3.5 years, and certainly he knew more probably by being a cousin of Jesus. Anybody have anything that they want to say about the life of John here?
I know Jesus said that I am the vine, and the fruit and the vine.
He that abideth in me hath life. And so, yes, he's given these I am's. John certainly gives us these. And so he's given us a lot of information. And really, he becomes one of the most beloved of the Gospels, although he doesn't give us the narrative of the birth of Christ. Most folks would say that his Gospel gives us details that are very important for our relationship with Jesus Christ. Turn to John chapter number 2. And where is our record? And we want to read about the first of these 35 miracles that we read about Jesus giving, doing. And as we look at this first miracle, there's some practical truths, there's some insights for us as the Christian. So I'm going to do some reading. You can follow along. I'll do it more as a commentary. I know that I've already taken up a chunk of time. This isn't going to be a large chunk of time tonight, but I do feel like we have some things that we want to say. The Bible says, and the third day. Now, a couple different opinions about what this third day means. Some feel that it's the third day since Jesus has left the wilderness of temptation. Some folks feel that it is the third day since the calling of Philip or Nathaniel. Some folks feel that it is the third day. They're looking at it being a Wednesday because by Jewish tradition, all virgins got married on Wednesday. Isn't that interesting? Does anyone know who got married on Thursdays? Want to take a guess? Widows. Widows got married on Thursdays according to Jewish tradition. So I, once again, I'm the fellow of the third day. I can read that. I can gain some insight. But Brother Doug, that's not a heaven or hell issue, and I'm not going to go toe-to-toe and nose-to-nose with someone over it. The Bible says that there was a marriage in Canaan of Galilee, about 15 miles away from the Sea of Galilee. This wedding is being held. And the Bible says, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. Let's stop there. Let's talk about this for a few minutes. Some feel that maybe all of his disciples were not chosen at this point, that maybe there's only 6 or 7 there. Others feel that all 12 were there. Interesting thought in itself. But here it is. We know that this is where his first miracles happen. He's been invited to the wedding. His mother's been invited to the wedding. Is it family? Certainly it looks like that Mary has some close relationship with whoever this is by what continues to transpire. But Jesus has been invited to the wedding. Stop there for a minute. Now I know we have a long way to some folks get married. But let's just stop and say this. There is a message in itself here that even in a wedding, we need to invite Jesus. There are some things that I read that I thought were interesting. There's all kinds of things that are worldly about weddings. All kinds of things. Some can be known as parties. Some can be known as drinking. And, you know, God doesn't stamp his approval on that. What we're looking at here is not some alcoholic indulged wedding that Jesus is being a part of. But here we find that Jesus is being invited. Do you know that even in our culture, it is so worldly that most brides and bridesmaids dress very seductive during their wedding? Ask a young and modest lady who's trying to find a modest wedding dress. It can be a challenge. You know, God even wants to be involved in the modesty of weddings. God wants to be involved in the activity, everything that's transpiring in the wedding. God wants to be involved that those who get married are not unequally yoked. But God wants believers to be yoked with believers. So, inviting Jesus to the wedding. And that's what they did. Isn't it interesting that the very first miracle Jesus did was at a wedding? I think that speaks some volume in itself. God honors marriage. I know culture says, let's shack up and try it out. We'll lose our benefits if we get married. That's on both ends of the spectrum. I've heard it from young and I've heard it from old. It's amazing what you hear when you work a secular job with lots of people. God honors marriage, bottom line. I'm not trying to preach to the choir tonight, but it's a reminder to us that as we stand upon God's word, those who engage in sexual activity without the bonds of marriage before marriage is called fornication. It's sin. Those who've been married and engage in it outside the realms of their marriage vows, it's called adultery. It's sin. It is sin. And I know it's infringing upon the church world more and more. But sin is still sin. And so, he's called, him and his disciples, and they're invited to the wedding. I'm trying to read my handwriting, I'm sorry. What happens when you don't type things out? The Bible says, and when they wanted wine, the word for wine here is O-I-N-O-S. It is neither fermented nor non-fermented. That is the word that is in the original text. But the indication throughout the Word of God, when we look at it systematically, would be indicated that it is non-fermented because it brings balance from the whole Word of God. So here they are, and they're running out of wine. This grape juice, and that's what I'll refer to it as. And the Bible says that the mother of Jesus, which is Mary, we know her by name. It's very, very interesting that when John gives reference to her, most often he refers to her as the mother of Jesus, not Mary. Not that he's trying to bring her to a low place, but I think he's trying to speak to a very important need that is represented, that she is the mother of Jesus. That's it. Not Mary to be prayed to. Not Mary. So he is already addressing this issue when we look at his writing. The mother of Jesus, and she said unto him, we have no wine. Now, a couple different things. Could it be that the Spirit of God is already dealing with the heart of Mary? That he's able to do a miracle. I'm concerned about these folks, Brother Doug, who are my friends, because wine is given, Sister Beth, for hospitality. Hospitality is very, very important in this culture. They want to make sure that they are hospitable. This grape juice is also equated with joy and laughter. And so this wedding, there's two things that I want my friends to have. I want it to be equated with a joyous time, and I want it to be equated with hospitality. That's what they've done their best to have. Weddings are a lot of work, aren't they? Yeah. Aren't you glad you only have to do it one time for the most part? That's kind of, you know, your spouse will pass away and you can do it again. But, you know, once is enough, right? It's a lot of work. So all the work that's being done, the hospitality, the joy that's equated with it. Mary said, Jesus, can you do a miracle? He's able to restore joy. Mommy. He's able to mend relationships that they're hospitable. And so it wasn't the Holy Ghost that was dealing with her, saying this could be the time. You know that he's the Son of God and he can do the miracle. And Jesus said unto her, woman, what have I to do with you? Now, let me just say, I don't think that we should refer to our mother as woman. Woman? Or even your wife. Woman? That's not the terminology Jesus was using. If you look back at what his terminology was, he would be referring to her as madam. Madam, what have I to do with you? The language implies that Mary, probably at this time her husband Joseph is dead from what we can see, and he said, my hour is not coming. He said, listen, you can tell me that, but I need to hear from God. I need the Holy Ghost to direct me.